for a V-layer, so this was just substrate decoration. And equal one is just substrate decoration, and on top of this one here. Here is a V-layer. You see we have different types of pinning centers. So when you add another YPCO field on the second quasi layer of silver dots, you see that the type of defects created are quite different. Also, the position of the maximum, you see it's changed. Three layer, four layers, this is already quite thick film. It has a big critical current, because we know that what is important is not just the current density, but the critical current. That's the parameter that is useful for us. So as soon as we can take thick films without depleting a lot of critical current density, this is very good for practical applications. Okay, and this is, let's say, how higher is JC in comparison with the pure white slope for this super lattices at 77.3 and 70 kilobit. The highest JC is for B layer, but in fact the higher critical current is for the 3 layer. This is something which I can't explain at this moment why we have that. So this one will be 2.5 micrometer thick. It's already decreased a lot, but again, in terms of critical current, they are still better than the YPC. This is the first YPC of the nanostructure target with a 4% value zircon A. And we have grown at 780 degrees and 800 degrees Celsius. The results in terms of nanostructure and in terms of mineral current density are different. Normal surface, in most cases, still the dominant. For this one, at 65 Kelvin, normal point seems to be the dominant one. And this is the value. So, 1.5 micrometer wide is your red ones, yep. 1.5 micrometer at 70 is your dot, at 780 is this one. And this one, even thicker than this two, grown at 800 degrees Celsius, has the best critical current density as you can see. Same things also.
Talks about two components Logos. They gave a nice talk and a very nice introduction, so I won't take too much time on that. But just to recall you about this result, experimental result of MG2, and this album is called Platform of 5 Superconductivity, and this is a strange vortex arrangement of these systems, because you have both repulsive and attractive interaction between vortices, and this comes from different events in the superconductor. So, of course, this is a very controversial result, but there are many simulations being performed that more or less corroborate these results, or at least say that this is possible. Some of these simulations are performed on the framework of pair potential calculated by an instrumental model. But I have to warn you that you cannot use molecular dynamics simulation with pair potential, because this is not a two-body problem, it's a many-body problem, because there is strong coalescence between the vortex scores. Interesting, because at least from my point of view, as someone that's performing the Minsky molecular calculation, I know very well that the best fit between Minsky molecular simulations and theory comes from mesoscopic superconductivity. So I hope that we can have a better agreement between theory and experiment if the experimentalists, they move to the subject of mesoscopic to dense superconductivity. So there are many interesting things that can happen here. This type 1.5 superconductivity is based on interactions between vortices that has this structure here. So they are composite vortices. Okay. So this is the only possible structure that a vortex can have in a both superconductor, two band superconductor. Okay. Well, but if you have not a both superconductor but a mesoscopic superconductor, because of the interface between superconductor and vacuum, you can stabilize non-composite forces. And even non-composite forces that has a fraction of flux. And this means that the winding number in different bands of the material are different. Okay, so this will lead to a fraction of flux. So these are the structures that I'm interested in. And I'll show to you how we can stabilize structures like that. Some ideas on how this could be possibly measured experimentally, and how can we use a magnetic dot to make it more stable. Okay, so this is only a theoretical work, there's no experiment here, and this is based on this two-component Minsky-Lambda model. So this is the free energy function I already showed to you, and of course, there is a strong debate on the validity of this theory. So there was some strong claims that this theory is not appropriate to describe to dense superconductors. But then this year came out a comment that said, "Oh, this is all wrong." And well, there's a big fight over there. And then the same authors they published another paper where they make kind of microscopic justification of the two components in the blood of the field. Okay? So my feeling is that at least qualitatively we can have some nice physics coming out from this blood of theory that could possibly be tested experimentally. So that's the theory that we use to study this. Okay? Thank you for dropping in my slot. I apologize for the technical difficulties, but the reason I'm having such difficulties is that I try to make the talk more entertaining for you, and what is a lot of information, movies, which I'm afraid not all will work now. I will talk about quasonics and the twice fractionalization. You've heard about this already from Plessio, but quasonics has been very weakly represented in this workshop so far. The work, this is theoretical work that I will show it, and I will try to not go too deep in theory and show more phenomenologically the results. The work was done at the University of Antwerp in collaboration with the University of Serra. Some of them you know, they're here, and with me as a bridge in between. Now, so what do I mean by flexonics? So as we all know, vortices move under applied drive. So if we apply current to a superconductor carrying, say, a vector of lattice of vortices, vortices will move perpendicularly to the applied drive, analogously to the Lorentz force. Of course, this is not the Lorentz force, it's very often said it's Lorentz force, this is a Magnus force, if you want to be exact, but the terminology is the same. So vortices move, dissipate energy, heat your sample, destroy superconductivity. So this is a problem. And people always want to solve this problem, and partial solution is vortex spinning. Of course, you have vortex spinning in every material due to imperfections and defects, but you can also strategically place defects and have an underlying lattice, for example, of holes in your superconductor, which will attract vortices, or have magnetic particles deposited in a certain structure of your superconductor so that you nano-engineer the magnetic field but not the superconductor itself. In either case, these spinning sites will interact with vortices and prevent their motion. Now, once we realized how to do this, the people said, can we use this knowledge to make something useful out of the vortices? Then flexonics came from analogy to electronics. So vortices, electrons are electromagnetic fields, have certain duality in the sense that electric current drives vortices the same like electric field drives electrons. You have moving vortices that produce voltages, like mobile electrons produce currents. And the resistivity of vortex transport is basically analogous to conductivity of electron transport. So more or less everything we know for electrons, and this has been studied for ages, we can apply to vortices and try to control their motion in a certain fashion. So the first device that was made was actually a ratchet device, which with the idea to remove vortices from the system. So nothing else useful than that, but still, if you have asymmetric potentials created and you apply AC drive, and you heard this from Joris van Bommel in his presentation, vortices will move in one direction. That motion will always be in one direction. Vortices will be can be removed from the system, for example. But of course, there are applications like as proposed in this paper in 2005. The Canada, of course, some of you will know, she's from Rio de Janeiro. The idea is to have a superconductor on top of a diluted magnetic semiconductor. So the field of the vortex creates a very large change of magnetic field over a very short distance, which creates Zeeman splitting in the semiconductor. It localizes charges, and moreover, the spins will follow the magnetic field lines. So you'll have charge and spin textures in your semiconductor, the diluted magnetic semiconductor, which are controlled by vortices. So if you can move vortices, you can also manipulate spin and charge textures. So you can envisage some devices like this, where you have a superconductor, this is a vortex, you move the vortex with current along these channels, but in the underlying DMS, you have spins transported from one side to the other. So you get some kind of spin batteries, or you have spin pumps. You can do that also with an AC drive, if instead of these channels, you have some ratchet-like asymmetric channels. This is just to give you a flavor of a possible device. Now, what do? We solve the majority of the things that I'll show you are about obtained by Gins-Morlando theory, and you saw this equation several times in the last few days. We have two Gins-Morlando equations which we solve self-consistently. Now, this is a stationary situation where we can map these equations on a numerical grid and use typically linked variable approach to discretize our first equation, where psi, of course, you know, is the order parameter, and A is the vector potential from a magnetic field. And for the second equation, if you pay attention, this is actually a Poisson type of equation, and very efficient solver is the fast Fourier transform. This is very well known in literature, and this is what one can use. To speed up convergence, you can also play some tricks with this nonlinear term. The nonlinear term is the biggest problem in this type of problem.